If you've ever tried to use Canon's free technical LUTs, then you've probably been confused by this folder structure here, which has multiple levels of confusing names. In this video, I'm going to dissect what all this means so you can make the right LUT choice for you. First off, you have 3D and 1D LUTs. So what is 3D versus 1D? Long story short, you can take the 1D LUTs and delete them. Long story long, 1D LUTs only deal with brightness and contrast, not with color information. And when you're shooting in a wide color space, like Canon Cinema Gamut, which you probably are if you need to use one of these LUTs, then 1D is just blatantly insufficient. Now with 3D LUTs, the 3 comes from red, green, and blue, the 3 color channels. Whereas a 1D LUT would basically be the equivalent of making adjustments to this, where things can be brought down or brought up, but the colors within those luminance values get no direction at all. So now that we've narrowed it down to 3D LUTs, we have 3 different options for the number of grids within the 3D LUT: 17, 33, and 65. Essentially, you want a higher number because that is a more precise, detailed conversion with essentially less rounding errors, and having a lower grid number and therefore a less precise transformation could result in banding issues and other artifacts in the footage. You can actually open up any LUT as a text document and see it's literally thousands of conversions. So it makes sense that the more detailed these conversions are, the better the end result. But there are instances where you just flat out can't use a 65 grid LUT. For example, a lot of cameras and monitors where you want to load your LUTs in to view them on set don't allow 65 grid. But when editing, why not always use a 65 grid LUT? I was always told that 8-bit footage from like a DSLR or mirrorless camera should use a 17 grid LUT. 10-bit footage from a cinema camera should use a 33 grid LUT, and then raw footage from a cinema camera should use the 65 grid LUTs. And although that's probably a good rule of thumb, there's no law saying that you can't use the better LUT, like a 65 grid, for 10-bit footage, like coming out of this C70. So after spending some time the past month or two researching LUTs, I've realized that maybe I should try using a 65 grid LUT for my C70 instead of the 33 grid LUT that I've always used.
So let's test these LUTs side by side with some footage from a lens flare video I'm working on. I have one adjustment layer with the 33 grid LUT and one adjustment layer with the 65 grid LUT. So let's toggle between them to see if there's any difference. We have Grogu here with some weird lined bokeh. You see tiny shifts in certain values, but when looking at the footage and toggling back and forth, I don't see any difference. Now let's test them with actual skin to see if there's any difference in the skin tone, back, forth. I just see tiny variations in the waveform, but not in the actual footage again. But let's run one final test where we really stress the footage.
So to create some banding, I shined a light directly on the wall. I put a CTO gel on in front of the light, so this should be a good stressor for the different LUTs. There's a pretty nice round curve here in the 65 grid LUT, and the 33 is kind of jagged. And I think that's where you're really seeing the rounding errors of the 33 grid LUT, is in these intense colored gradients. Might as well use the most precise calculation. And now inside the last folder, you have 25 LUTs to choose from. First half of the name, what you shot. Second half of the name, what you want. It's a little confusing because the ones they put at the top are the ones that you're probably never going to use, BT709 or BT2020. That means that you shot with a 709 color space and not Cinema Gamut. Most people, for most situations, I don't think would ever be shooting in a log profile to capture maximum dynamic range, but not be shooting in a wide color gamut to get the most color information. So you can go right ahead and delete those. Now, did you shoot in C-Log2 or C-Log3? Most people, for most things, shoot in C-Log2 because it has the most dynamic range. It's a little counterintuitive. You know, you might think 3 is a higher number, it's better. It's only called 3 because it came out after C-Log2, but it's actually a dumbed down version of C-Log2. I have a video comparing the two if you want to check that out. But you do get more shadow information in C-Log2, so that is the industry standard, the professional thing that everyone shoots. So for most people, I would even go ahead and just delete those. But I'm not going to, because some cameras don't let you shoot C-Log2. Non-cinema cameras in particular, that people use as cinema cameras, don't usually have C-Log2, so you might have to use C-Log3, which is still great. So these are basically two different buckets of all the same LUTs, and essentially you probably just want the top one, BT709YDR. There are instances where you would want something besides BT709, but for most people, for most things, if you're a beginner and watching this video, you want BT709 wide DR. That will give your footage a nice contrasty saturated base, which you can then further tweak. I've included a link in the description that takes you to the C70's page, and under software, Canon lookup tables. You might be asking yourself though, are there better LUTs out there than the free ones that Canon gives me? Yes, there are. And you can check out this video right here that I made recently comparing a slew of third-party LUTs that I purchased to compare to Canon's.